have a book, The Night Divided, that we chose. Okay, and it's by Jennifer A. Nielsen. Jennifer A. Nielsen. Okay, let's start on chapter one. Okay. Chapter one. When I want the West to scream, I squeeze on Berlin. Nikita Brushev, Soviet Union Premier, 1958 to 1964. There was no warning the night the wall went up. I woke to sirens screaming throughout the city of all East Berlin. Instantly, I flew from my bed. Something must have gone terribly wrong. Why were there so many? Although it was a warm morning, that wasn't a reason for my sweaty palms or flushed face. My first thought was that it might be an air raid. My parents had described them to me from the Second World War. I pulled my curtains apart, expecting the worst. But when I looked out, my heart slammed into my throat. Not even the darkest part of my imagination could have prepared me for this. It was Sunday, August 13th, 1961, a day I would remember for the rest of my life. When a prisoner had been built around us, we had slept. When a prison had been built around us as we slept. Lines of Grenzers are nicknames for the border police. The Grenzertruppen stood guard along the fence of thorny wire. In some places higher than their heads, and as for far as my eyes could see, they stood like iron statues with stern expressions and long rifles in their hands. It was obvious that anyone who tried to cross the fence would get far worse than a rip in their clothes. Because the Grenzers didn't face the Westerners on the other side of the fence, they watched us. It was very clear who planned to shoot if there was any trouble. Only if I looked out earlier, during the night, I heard strange noises of hammering, heavy footsteps, and hushed conversations from the men with sharp voices. But I rolled over and told myself it was only a dream, or a nightmare perhaps. If I'd looked, I could have warned my family in time, just as our neighbor, Herr Kraus, tried to warn us. He knew this was coming. Hadn't he said for years the government was not to be trusted? That we might salute the flag of East Germany. But that was really Russia we bowed to, and my father had known. My father! As if she heard my thoughts from out in the kitchen, I heard Mama screaming, Aldous, that was his name. And with a final glance out the window, I remembered the reason for Mama's screams. My father wasn't here, nor was my brother Dominic. They had been in the West for two nights and were supposed to come home later. With an endless row of guns and soldiers between the fence, just like that, just changed it. I raced to my room and arrived in the kitchen to see my oldest brother, Fritz, holding my mother in his arms as she sobbed on his shoulder. He eyed me and cocked his head toward the window case I hadn't already seen in the fence. I'd only brushed my tears from my eyes and wrapped my arms around her back. Maybe she didn't need me, but that moment, I desperately needed her. She felt me there, putting a shaking hand on my arm. They've done it, Goethe, she said through her tears, worse than anyone ever thought. Mama had been a beautiful woman once, but that was years ago. She has come through too much war and famine years ago. In poverty, to care about the curl in her hair or the neatness of her dress. Her blonde hair was already turning gray, and her bore early wrinkles into creases. Sometimes I look in the mirror and hoped my life would not be equally hard on me. "Why now?" I asked. "Why today?" I looked up to Fritz for an answer. He was nearly 6 years old than me, and the smartest person I ever knew, next to my father. If my mother had no answers, then he surely did. But all he could do was shrug and hold her tighter as her sobs grew louder. Besides, I already understood more than I wanted to. The fence was only the beginning. It had just divided my life in half, and nothing would ever be the same again. Chapter 2. I had known something bad was coming ever since the knock on our door Friday evening. 2 days before the fence, we were in the middle of supper. My parents were discussing the day's news, as they always did. Hatred between the East and West was growing, and Berlin seemed caught in the center of what was described as a cold war. A standoff was loud threats and puffed out chests. Hopefully, it wouldn't lead to anyone bringing out their guns. Germany still hadn't recovered from the last war. Across the table from me, Fritz and Dominic were debating who would get the last dumpling. My oldest brother, or the hungriest, and I was telling all of them to be quiet. That I heard something. Someone knocked again. This time, everyone went silent. Papa wiped his mouth with napkins after a warning glance for us to remain calm. He went to answer the door, though my mother whispered that everything was fine. I was already nervous. Whenever unexpected knocks came, my heart waited to beat again until I knew who it was. 8 years ago, my father had been involved in some worker uprising in Berlin. He had never been arrested for that, and insisted he did nothing to deserve any special attention. But that Stasi, our secret police force, seemed to disagree. Every few months, they came back to ask him questions, looking at him as if he'd already found guilty of something. I always wondered what they were waiting for, a reason to take him away. This time, however, my father's face widened into a smile, and into a welcoming voice he said, "Herr Kraus," then pulled the older man into our apartment with a warm embrace. "Have you had supper, my friend?" "Thank you, but I can't stay." Herr Kraus lived next door with his invalid wife. He was a bit odd, collecting scraps, anything that wasn't nailed down and stuff, wherever Stasi might not look. He and my father knew each other as long as I could remember, and had been at that uprising together. Mama told me that he definitely should have been arrested, but we weren't wise to associate with him. But when he came in, she left her seat and gave him a polite greeting. The more she disliked our company, the nicer Mama was. The lesson learned from our visits with the Stasi. "How can we help you?" she asked. Herr Kraus kissed her cheek and dismissed any further pleasantries with a frown at my father. "We need to talk." Papa invited him to sit down while Mama said, "Children, go to your rooms." We stood to obey her, but Papa said, "Fritz should stay." "No, Aldous. He's 14 years old. Fritz should stay." Mama gave on that argument, but waved Dominic and me off to our rooms. However, I only went to my bedroom door down the hallway, shut it as if I'd gone outside, and crept back to the corner. Dominic watched me in an amused smile, then did the same thing. "The whispers are growing louder," Herr Kraus said. The government has got to act before East Germany is completely empty. I already understood that. Our government had closed a border years ago, hoping that that would stop the flood of people leaving for the brighter lights of West. But there were always ways through. Another family from our apartment building had left just yesterday, disappearing without a word to anyone. The same thing happened all over East Germany, especially here in the city. So you think they'll begin arresting people who try to leave? Mama asked. No, Herr Kraus said. I think it'll be worse than that. Your family must get over to the west while you still can, from around the corner. I nodded in agreement. Why couldn't my mother see what was so obvious about Papa and Herr Kraus and others who felt trapped here beneath Moscow's thumb? According to Papa, for the last 16 years, Germany had been split up between the East and the West. Our people are divided for no reason other than what street they happen to live on. That part of the punishment was losing the Second World War. Break our country into pieces so we couldn't rise up and threaten the world again the way Hitler had done it. Now, Britain, America, and France controlled the western half of Germany, as well as half of the capital of Berlin. Russia controlled the east, where my family lived. At first, it didn't matter much to us. Most people shopped here first, but at first, it didn't matter much. People had visited just as they always had, and crossing the border wasn't a problem. But Russia promises a life under communism. And as the West repaired its war damages, are remaining like unhealed scars. The shops were full, and ours faced constant shortages. They were growing stronger, while we leaned on Russia like a crutch, pretending to be every bit as strong. People had noticed the widening gap between our countries as more Eastern Berliners left each week. Those of us who remained weak whispered in the dark corners about what we left to. I heard them. I watched as our neighbors and friends made their plans to go. My father was one of those ones who whispered. Our family would have gone to the West months ago if Mama had let us. She was just as stubborn as he was, I suppose. They argued all the time about it, in whispers, of course. Berlin was a symphony of whispers. But this is also our home, and Mama could imagine leaving more than she could think about ceasing to be German. Choose to go now, Herr Kraus said, or soon you will have no choice. You want to leave our life that we've built here, Mama said. My widowed mother lives outside the city. She needs my help. Should I leave too? We should ask you to stay here. Herr Kraus asked, where is it dangerous to speak or act or to even think? It's only dangerous because you fill my husband's head with ideas he should not have. Then Mama lowered her voice. This was not the kind of conversation she wanted our neighbors to hear, at least. Not the neighbors who wanted to report us to the Stasi. She turned her attention to Papa. Besides, our children live here, and you have a secure job. They have schools in the West, Papa told her. We can find a new home, new job. The refugee camps in the West are crowded and don't have enough food to go around, Mama shook her head. After the war, she had gone for months without food to eat. Thousands of Germans died of hunger back then, and I knew that the memory of war is never far from over for her. We have no family or friends there to take us in, and I won't bring my children into a camp. We're not beggars. I'd rather beg than live here. I left hiding my place spoken, even though I remember I was supposed to be in my room. But it was too late to go back, so I added, please, Mama, listen to them. You should go to bed, Gerda. What if Aldous goes to the west for a night or two? Herr Kraus suggested. He can find you a new apartment and ask about jobs. Papa's voice brightened. I can leave tonight and be back on Sunday. We don't have to decide anything for sure until I come back. Mama was silent for a moment. Then she said, bring one of your children so the employers know you have a family to support. I'll go, Fritz offered, as he knew he would last week. Fritz told me he wanted to buy some of the West magazines and come back here to sell them to his friend. You need to help your mother with packing, and Gerda is too young, Papa said. I'll take Dominic. Dominic came around the corner, smiled as he won sort of prize. I glared at him, but the truth was, I thought he had won a prize too. Why couldn't Papa bring me instead? I asked Papa that very same question when he tucked me into bed that night. He smiled and pulled the blankets up to my chin. It's going to be difficult to get across the border in the darkness, he said. Dominic and I will find a way to return, and I'll show you in for a few more nights. His eyes became sad, though the smile remained. I must come back, but nobody else knows our bedtime song. He's got his feet dancing to my favorite song, The Farmer and the March, which described all the chores of a farmer must do. They have a lot to do in the home and the garden, he sang as he began phantoming the words. They dig and they rake and they sing a song. They sang along with him until the very last line. Then he kissed my cheek, wished me a good sleep, and closed the door of my room, saying, I'll see you on Sunday, Gerda. No, he wouldn't, because 2 days later, our city would be surrounded by an endless fence of wire and thorn. As I was about to learn, he would never come back. Eventually, Mama dried her tears and told me and Fritz to go get dressed, that we ought to see the fence for ourselves. It was still very early in the morning, and large bulldozers could be heard, already tearing down homes, or along with most of the people in my neighborhood. I stood on the road, facing the guns that faced us. Mama held one of the hands of Fritz and held one other, and the other. No one around me cried, and not even the strongest men fought back. Why didn't we? I looked around, waiting for someone to rush at the officers in a cry for freedom. Then others would join into the fight until we overpowered the guards and showed them that we refused to be held like criminals, or until enough of us were shot. The guards looked prepared to do that if necessary. Probably everyone here already understood that, because like me, I only stood and watched. Maybe we were all too empty for tears and horrified for words. When I asked Fritz and Papa and Dominic would be able to come home, he knelt beside me and shook his head. Quietly, he whispered, Papa was part of the resistance, Gerda, or they think he was. As long as that fence is up, they will never let him come home, and he won't send Dominic back to this place. Don't worry, I'm sure it can't last long. The people around me have already given a name to this day. Barbed Wire Sunday. The day that divided the city, and eventually a country. Worst of all, the day that divided my family. The sun warmed my back as it slowly rose in the east, and I shivered against it. This early morning light had not ended a long, dark night. No. For us, the dark night had only begun.